Good morning. Thank you so much for being here, and it's a pleasure for me to address all of you at this hour, despite the strike and all the logistical challenges you and actually me have encountered in getting here. So since you can see by my dress code that I do not represent a government or a corporation or even a university, I think I'm allowed to say a few things that will provoke. And hopefully, I will leave you at least with one provocation that you will vehemently agree or disagree with, which, you know, judging by most conferences I attend, is already a mark of success. So one parallel that I would like to leave you with today is that 10 years after the profound financial crisis that have shaken all society to the core, we are living through another crisis of proportions and magnitudes that perhaps are even greater in size, but it's a crisis that is very different in that it's mostly invisible and is taking place in slow motion. And the crisis that I'm referring to is not an economic one, it's a digital and a technological one, but it's marked just like the economic predecessor 10 years ago by the same degree of short-sightedness and blindness and partial vision. On behalf of two key players that I think need to become a little bit more awakened to the challenges in front of them. And those two players, I think, are very easy to guess. On the one hand, I talk about the industry, including investors. And on the other hand, I talk about governments and policymakers. And I would like to spend quite a bit of time explaining what I perceive as those rather short-sighted and tunnel vision-like approaches in what they do and how they do it, but also what are some of the ways for them to get out of them. So I'm very happy that we're actually being and discussing these issues in this room, because if you can look around this fantastic socialist utopia that you see on the wall by, you know, the GDR painter and artist Gunther Brendel, you will see that the vision outlined on the walls in front and around of you is not very different from the vision that a lot of technology platforms and Silicon Valley entrepreneurs would like to present to us, with one exception. So you see a lot of very harmonious utopian activity going on, a lot of collaboration, people are engaging in what you might otherwise describe as a sharing economy of some kind. There is even some kind of a biking competition, everybody is very happy and everybody is very keen to be enjoying themselves surrounded by quite a lot of modern technology. Right? But if you look at this painting closer, of course you will see that there is one key difference between the utopia and the reality, and it's those workers in the middle of the painting, right? Who are there and very happy, and you can see that they're very engaged, and they would like to get back to the fields or the factories and whatever else they engaged in, right? The happiness that we see in front of us now does not really have a very good answer as to what will happen to those people. Right? Which I think causes quite a lot of anxiety and discontent among the workers, but also among the population at large. And if you actually go and look a little bit closer, how does Silicon Valley square the circle, so to say? How do they actually make their vision still hold? You will see that they have essentially two solutions that I think are not very realistic and not very plausible. Solution number one is that through some kind of magic wand, through some kind of, you know, mysterious occurrence, all of us will receive a basic income of some kind, so none of us will have to work, and we'll just go back to those biking competition and the beach and the dancing party, and we'll just enjoy the life to the fullest as everything gets automated away, right? How exactly that will get realized, given that these companies are also very often in the avant-garde of tax evasion and tax minimization, if you'd like to be more diplomatic, is not obvious. Where the money to fund the consequences of this automation will come from is not obvious as well. The second answer that this industry holds in front of us is somewhat less honest, but nonetheless, it's the one that they use most often. And they often tell us that that side of you that had to do with production, that had to do with work, that had to do with industrial activity, industrial strategy, is not really important. We just have to focus on making things cheaper. Right, making them more attractive to consumers, and this is where platforms, data, algorithms, big data, sensors, the smart city, and everything comes in. The idea is that essentially you can forget thinking about this productive side. All you need to think about is how we can deploy technology to make things more affordable for people. And the fact that their income's actually stagnating or declining will not matter much because everything will be either free or it will be available much cheaper. And if you look at what has happened in the last decade or so, you can actually see that there has been some truth to that statement. And it had to do mostly with one very simple development, that there was a lot of free idle capital after the financial crisis that was willing to enter the technology sector and actually fund the development of many of those platforms and subsidize them. So you end up in situations where companies like Uber can actually lose $4 billion a year, which is what happened to Uber last year, and still be in business, and still offer rates that are relatively low, and thus favor the, and thus gain the favor of many of the customers, right? But how long can that continue? And I would argue that that cannot continue for long. And the model behind Uber, it's not an exception. Virtually much of the digital economy operates like that. It's a lot of money coming from governments that are clever, you know, the government of Saudi Arabia, the Gulf states, many of the countries in Southeast Asia, dumping a lot of money, which some of it they even borrow, it's not the money that they invest that comes from their own economies, into the development of digital platforms, hoping that they will end up with these champions that will be player number one, and perhaps the only player in many of these verticals, from housing, from hospitality, to bike sharing, car sharing, and everything else. Right? I would argue that this is a model that up until now has appealed to many of us because it has been very cheap and affordable. It will not and cannot possibly be as attractive as things move on. For one simple reason, that for a company like Uber to be able to recoup the losses that they have incurred over the last 5 or 10 years would require two things. It's either that once they achieve the massive scale that they're aiming for and they destroy the competition locally because competition cannot afford to lose $4 billion a year, they're going to eventually raise prices and raise rates and thus actually make up for whatever it is that they have lost, or on the other hand, they will actually have to speed up the automation process and thus get rid of the drivers entirely and actually roll out self-driving cars, thus keeping the rates that they're charging right now unchanged. Right? Which is one vision, but that vision, of course, has very dystopian future in front of us because the part of the economy that currently is still integrated into the provision of the services, the drivers, will eventually have to do something else. And the money that previously was spent locally on buying things, on you know, drivers buying cars or newspapers or coffee, all of that will be gone as well. Right? I'm not against it. I would actually think that if you manage to combine that automation part with the previous proposal of introducing basic income, it might actually work. The problem is that all of the savings and all of the profits that will be made with that automation, it will not stay in the local economy. Under the current conditions on which the digital economy operates, all that money will flood to the clever investors that stand behind companies like Uber, which will be the sovereign wealth fund of Saudi Arabia, it will be SoftBank, and it will be a couple of other players that have lent this company so much money. So there is an inherent inconsistency in that vision, and I think that, if anything, the workers that are currently very happy in that painting will actually be quite angry and will be following into the steps of the people that are currently rioting all over France. Right? Because ultimately, that's the future that unfortunately presupposes that somehow all the money to consume, all those fantastic services will come from somewhere, but the future doesn't even tell us where exactly that will come from. So, and you know, I can go much deeper into the blindness of the industry on this, and I can assure you that there is much blindness to go around. Just look at artificial intelligence, right? Look at how much money is going into training, essentially the services of 5 or 7 firms to perform exactly the same set of activities. Look at what it is that Amazon or Google or Microsoft are training their AI and machine learning systems to do. All of them are starting with data sets, which are rather trivial, to train their systems to perform the same set of basic services. You know, we need to be able to recognize a cat from a dog, a traffic light from a car, you know, one face from another face. I mean, those are very useful skills. I would just challenge you to come with a reasonable justification why that requires those companies pouring $10 billion or $15 billion a year into essentially producing the same set of skills that if you truly had global governance and if you truly thought about global public goods, you would just do it once, you would save far lot of money, and you would actually find a way in which to make that global public good accessible to people and countries and industry more widely. So again, I would just like to emphasize that much of the activity that we are currently seeing that is actually producing some savings and that is producing a lot of services, once you take a different perspective on it, it's far from efficient, far from effective, and far from sustainable. And I'm not even talking about the massive amounts of money that goes into those parts of the sharing economy that once the money exits, actually start clogging our streets. You know, I challenge you to go to Google Images and search for bike sharing in China. The first 50 images you will see will show you mountains of abandoned bikes. Mountains, which is the most terrible thing you can think that would happen to the environment, which is all the consequence of extremely irrational approach with tons of money, tons of funds, chasing something very simple, the provision of municipal bike sharing. Right? So there is something broken at the heart of the model, which I think we need to fundamentally rethink. Right? And I would get to how we can rethink it a little bit later, but I think it's very important to recognize that something at the heart of how the digital economy operates is not what it seems. And this is sort of the blindness on the private side. The blindness on the public side, I think, also has a lot of consequences that are very consequential. I know that today and tomorrow and in the next 6, 9, 12 months, as this debate about the digital economy heats up in Europe, you're going to hear quite a lot about the same set of issues. We need more and better data protection. We need Europe to catch up with the United States and China. We need to be able to have better antitrust laws when it comes to data. I think all of that is correct, but the short-sightedness and the blindness of this kind of talk and this kind of approach is has to do with the fact that the actual geopolitical and economic moment and political moment that we are living through now might not actually allow for this very cold and technocratic interventions that would have worked if we were undertaking them in the 70s or 1980s. Right? There is something very particular about where the world is heading now, which I think would make these kinds of interventions without being underpinned by a much more ambitious strategic vision of how society in general, not just the digital society, but society in general, from our interaction with the state to our interaction with the welfare state needs to be shaped up. Without that fundamental ambitious vision, I think no template for digital economy is going to essentially address the issues. So let me give you a few examples. If you look at how the extreme far right talks about the digital economy, you will understand that they have become the harshest critics of this industry. And they're the ones who are currently the most vocal in insisting on even something as far-fetched as data sovereignty for the people. Go and read the transcripts of speeches by somebody like Steve Bannon. Steve Bannon, in almost every second or third speech, makes one very simple point. Big tech is a big threat to society. Policymakers have done everything to integrate themselves with big tech. We need a populist revolution against it, and the solution they would like to propose is to give people ownership over the data that they're generating. Now, I'm not inventing those things. They actually say it. Now, I spent a lot of time in Italy for personal reasons, and if you Actually, listen to the discourse in Italy. The people who insist the most on empowering people versus big tech and giving them some sovereignty over the data and infrastructure, it's not even Salvini. It's people to the right of Salvini. It's Fratelli d'Italia, which is a party on the far right, even of Lega. Right? And I'm just giving you these examples to show that there is something in the air that sees big tech as an extension of this globalist technocratic beast that, of course, I do not see, and I do not see it as that at all, but a lot of people see it that way. And I would argue that without having a more ambitious transformative vision that is much more progressive and internationalist of how that beast can be tamed in a way that will address a lot of concerns and anxieties that ordinary people have about the future of democracy, about the future of the welfare state, no meaningful change will happen because the very basic foundations of policymaking that we are relying on to enact this digital agenda of mostly technocratic interventions, of more antitrust, more privacy, more data protection, they'll just fall apart. And they will fall apart under the pressure that does not just come from big tech, but that comes from elsewhere. So I think it's very important to keep that in mind. And the vision that I think we need will actually be able to take advantage of information technology, but it will deploy that information technology not just to empower ecosystems, which is, you know, the motto of this conference, but it will also use them to empower citizens. There is no long-term sustainable empowerment of ecosystems without the empowerment of citizens. I'm absolutely sure of that. And if you actually manage to take advantage of all the data that we are generating as we interact with each other, but also as we interact with the state, if you manage to deploy that in order to imagine what a very different, more horizontal, more decentralized economy and society would look like, what it is that you actually need to have under control to make that vision happen, I think you'll have a very different policy agenda. And I think, you know, we need to identify what are those necessary but not sufficient conditions for a more democratic, decentralized transformation of society that will not surrender this ground of this fight against the technocratic big state only to the extremist far right. And I think some of that would clearly require measures to keep things like digital identity under some kind of public control, keeping things like artificial intelligence not just as a private good or as a service available to everybody for a fee, but we'll actually reimagine it as a public good of some kind, because to some extent it is, because so much of it is produced with the data that we generate. We'll specify what the just and fair conditions of access to that public good are and what they should be. And we'll actually think of strong institutions that will be able to mediate those conditions of access. I can easily imagine a world where strong public sector of some kind will actually dictate who can have access to the public data that all of us are generating and on what terms, so that a foreign player, be that Google or Alibaba, might actually have to pay a little bit more for access to the data so that they can offer more services on top of it, while a local player, which might be a local SME or it might be a local NGO, will not only get access to it for free, but will actually receive some kind of a grant or an investment from some kind of a public venture fund in order to build a service that will satisfy the needs of local citizens in that particular neighborhood. I see absolutely nothing wrong, anti-capitalist or socialist, in that undertaking. I think we need to be able to facilitate the emergence of such local horizontal initiatives in society if we do not want to turn, you know, our political landscape into a repetition of what we are currently seeing in France, where there will be quite a lot of discontent with this top-down, centralized, technocratic mode of governance. And I think I've already told you that digital identity and keeping a strong control of it is one thing, which I think is fundamental, that we need to be able to resolve it, because ultimately, if we don't do that, we'll be moving into society where we're essentially privatizing ratings of citizens, which to some might be a very good way to keep citizens under control of some kind. To many others, it will actually be terrifying, Do you know that Facebook now assigns you a score, even though you do not know it, and you do not know how that score is produced, which then affects your visibility on the site? Right? Few of us know it, and few of us know that a lot of other services offer those ratings to us, and then those ratings then shape our interaction with each other, our interaction with the service, and potentially, once the infrastructures start being used as a proxy for identification systems, also our interaction with the state. Think about Australia and New Zealand, where if you have a rating lower than 4 on Uber, you're actually suspended from using the platform. I'm talking about the passenger, not the driver. So if your ultimate total rating on a platform like Uber falls below 4, forget about using Uber. Right? How would that affect the provision of transportation services, even in many European cities, which now actually actively contracting with firms like Uber to offer the services that were previously offered by the public sector? I can point you to Nice in France, which actually has contracted Uber to run nighttime transportation services in some parts of the city. What does future public sector look like, where our interaction with what used to be the public sector or the welfare state is shaped not just by private players, but by private players that actually have full control over things like identity, right? I just don't think that there is a sustainable long-term solution in not finding a better public social alternative to it, where instead of letting Uber, Airbnb, Facebook, and others rank us individually, as consumers, users of the services, would actually be able to imagine a very different solution where we will have a digital identity provided by the state, and those companies would be able to query that identity system in order to know whether we are actually eligible or not to receive certain services. That's a decision that, in my view, should still be mediated by the state and should not be mediated by the providers of the services. Not everywhere, but on something as crucial as education or healthcare, or even transportation, I would argue that that makes quite a lot of sense. So I think the main challenge that's facing us now is that we have to understand that the conditions under which the traditional tools and instruments of policymaking could be deployed to tame the big tech, the way we tamed, you know, the big oil or the big foot, and to be honest, I don't think we actually tame them, and somehow produce a result that will give us an utopia similar to this one, maybe with a little more capitalist enterprise around, I don't think that that is actually a very reasonable proposition. I think in addition to all this technocratic intervention, we will need a much more ambitious vision of how society and the state should be transformed, if only because big tech and technology in general, I think it's a special industry. It's not like making widgets, it's not like making oil, and it's not like even making cars, as hard as it might sound in Germany. There is something about information and data that integrates many spheres of our life, our cultural life, our social life, our political life, our economic life. It's an industry that spans virtually every other industry. It deserves a special treatment, and I think it also deserves to be thought and analyzed much more ambitiously than we have previously done. We're beginning to raise those questions, and I hope that the next 2 days will provide a very fruitful context in order to undertake this initiative even further. Thank you so much.